We'll move to the NDP caucus and Ms. Chender for 14 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, I guess I'll continue on this thread of the NSCC and education. But I guess specifically looking forward, we've heard a lot about the synergy. We've heard a lot about why it makes sense that this partnership has come into being. But I'm sort of interested in the specifics of what the ongoing relationship will be, particularly as it pertains to education and to students at the college. So I wonder if you could tell me from a programming perspective what that might look like and what advantage students of the Nova Scotia Community College will gain by the college being in partnership at COVE.
Mr. Montgomery.
So as the deputy responsible for post-secondary, obviously a keen interest to ensure that community college is a key player and key partner. But to help you understand a little bit, at their waterfront campus, if you walk on their bottom floor, over to the right is an energy component. And that's a component of the community college that's dealing with over 100 companies on energy. You go down to the hall to the left, there's an oceans component. That's a group of people that are dealing with several companies in the oceans. For example, J.P. DeVoe will tell you that his company got started because of applied research that the community college did of being able to survey the ocean floor. So they have, and then you get down the hall, and they have an industrial component where they're working with businesses to help up their game. It just blows you away what they're doing. This is an adjunct to that. So the community college will be like Dalhousie and others. As COVE unfolds, companies identify their needs. Then we identify what's appropriate for the community college, what's appropriate for Dal, et cetera. But obviously, the whole idea of COVE as private sector is the key part, but we know we need the post-secondary to support that. So maybe Jim might add to that if that's okay.
Mr. Hanlon?
Thank you. Maybe I'll just address the training and student element of that, just to complement what the deputy said. So the community college campus just down the road, the Ivany campus, is home to the advanced diploma program in ocean technology that you're probably aware of. It's been around for about 3 years. Small cohort of about a dozen or 15 students, most of whom already have an undergrad degree from one of the Nova Scotia universities. And they go back for a 12-month period to get a very applied training in ocean technology, in the use of ocean technology, in many ways similar to the advanced diplomas at COGS and other parts of the community college. So I think the COVE will be the waterfront for the advanced diploma program in ocean technology. My hope, though, in addition to just the campus down the road, we'll also be able to hook in the Nautical Institute in Port Hawkesbury, the Marconi campus in Sydney, COGS in Middleton, to try and bring the power of that full teaching capability. Another one that's not as well known, but it's important to note, is there's an advanced diploma in international business out of the Truro campus, led by a gentleman by the name of Leroy Lowe, who's an old colleague of mine. It's interesting to note that I would say half of the ocean tech companies in Nova Scotia hire their business development professionals from that program of the community college. So trying to, certainly the community college brings value to COVE. What I think COVE may bring in turn back to the community college is that ability to integrate those programs, to kind of inject the business needs more directly across all those campuses of the college. So I think it's very symbiotic. I think we'll benefit, and I think the college will benefit in the long term.
Thank you. And I guess following from that, I wonder in terms of employment, which would be the other part of your purview, Deputy, is there, I guess, first of all, are there cooperative opportunities that you're anticipating for students, engineering students, et cetera, who might be able to come to COVE and fulfill some of that? And then further, are there internship, mentorship, pilot programs of employment that are anticipated at COVE?
Mr. Montgomery.
Yeah, if you look at the whole innovation approach, that's how literally it works. So if IBM is working with six universities and a community college around needs, they also have young people that are in the IBM world working on solutions to help IBM. And the beauty of IBM, I think they hired their 500th employee this summer. Think about it. Almost every one of those young people have come from Nova Scotia and those six institutions and the community college that they've been dealing with. The spin-off for us as a province is those companies that get in these innovation hubs, they get better, smarter, and more profitable, they hire more people. And more importantly, a lot of, in the innovation area, take Dalhousie's Idea Building. When Dalhousie's Idea Building opens, you basically will have companies in there on a regular basis working with those engineer students around the resolution of problems and so on. The students get to work with a private corporation. Private corporation gets to see those students and how good they are. And a lot of times, and the data shows this, that even with co-op students, they'll hire them, particularly if the company's able to up their game and expand their business. So in that way, it's a win-win for both.
Thank you. I guess just looking at those two examples of IBM and the idea building, you know, in the first case, you have a single company. In the second case, you have an overarching educational institution. Here, we're talking about having 20 or 30 small, medium, and maybe a couple large size companies. So I guess I wonder, would it be Mr. Hanlon, your group, who would be bringing some overarching programming and opportunities like this to those companies? Would they be required or incentivized to take this approach with education? Because of course you are dealing with the private sector, mostly it seems like, you're dealing with all different kinds of companies. So how do we know that they're game for this approach?
Mr. Hanlon.
A couple things. I would say, just speaking to the co-op internship question for a second, because
sure.
we have a program that's in formation right now that goes something like this. One of the barriers to entry for small and medium companies is that it's difficult for them on a proportionate basis to hire interns and co-ops. It's a big percentage of their payroll.
Right.
It's a big percentage of their management time that's taken away. So our solution to that, and it's in formulation right now, would be to frankly bulk hire a cohort of students from the universities, from the colleges, under our brand, under the COVE brand, say a dozen, and then deploy them at a micro level on a project by project basis across a multitude of small industries. And that's had huge positive response from the small companies. There truly is a bit of a barrier there, mm-hmm. if I'm a 10-person company, to hire one co-op student on a continuous basis. So that's the kind of programming that we hope to inject into COVE to get more fluidity in that flow of students into the companies. I'll put another personal agenda on this, which is I think we need to do a better job collectively around entrepreneurial studies in our universities and in our college. It's not a foregone conclusion that every student coming out of these institutions is going to go to work for an employer. Some of them will, in fact, be starting new businesses, as I have in my history. And so I think one of the values of COVE would be to expose those students at the college, at the universities, to that option, to that opportunity to rub shoulders with other in-market entrepreneurs and learn from peers that are just a little bit ahead of them in the game. So that's another element of the programming that we're really excited about at COVE.
Thank you. That's very helpful. That sort of solves that missing piece in my brain around all of this. And I can't pass by the chance to ask a couple of questions about Dartmouth, since COVE is located in beautiful Dartmouth South. I understand that there have been questions from other members of this committee around its location here in the HRM. I, for one, am happy that it is. and so I just wanted to ask a couple of questions. One is, you know, there's a lot of, you spoke a bit about the assets near COVE, of which, you know, obviously there's the community college, there are many others, there's the Bedford Institute. I know that there's also a number of local suppliers and, in fact, other ocean tech companies like Ultra Electronics, which I know that you have been affiliated with in the past, Mr. Hanlon. And so I wonder if you could speak to, I guess these are two separate questions, but, you know, any past or anticipated relationships either from a supplier level or on a synergistic level with the existing resources right around that COVE campus.
Absolutely. I, you know, if you were to put dots in the map of where there are capabilities and capacities in ocean technology in Nova Scotia, frankly, the center of mass would be in Dartmouth, not in downtown Halifax. I think it's a fair comment to say when you include the Defense Lab and Bedford Institute and the multitude of in-market companies in Burnside and Woodside. So no question, it is the pulsing center of our industry here in Nova Scotia.
I'm going to have to quote you on all that.
Yeah, quote me anytime. And I live in St. Margaret's Bay, so I'm not even a local. But I think there is a supply chain here that we do need to recognize. So the kinds of things we're doing, so we're going to have prototyping capability within COVE so that small companies can actually go make their first prototype in the building without having to leave. But in doing that, what we're going to do is engage the local rich supply chain of machine shops and fabricators that are all over the region and engage them on a contract basis to do that rather than setting up a public sector competitor for them. We're going to bring them in on a concession contract basis to work with us around those kinds of things. So yeah, we're very sensitive to not only not disrupting the supply chain, but recognizing that it's a huge value. Like, again, if I go down to my friends in New England and they look at what we have here within, you know, a 20 kilometer radius of that site is every component you would ever need to have in an Ocean Tech product or service. So it's a huge value.
Thank you. And that does point to something that I know I've heard little rumblings of, is this going to be competition that's going to be challenging in some way to some of those very established other industries? Are there more specific examples of how that won't be the case and how they'll be able to participate? You mentioned prototyping. Are there others?
I think I'm a dyed-in-the-wool private sector entrepreneur, so I'm very sensitive to the issue of not wanting to be in competition. I think that runs the gamut from, as Jennifer said earlier, we've set this the pricing in COVE up to be on the high end as opposed to a low end of market. So we think we're in a good place because it's not a pure real estate play, but we are not in any way in competition with a landlord in Burnside. We're offering a different thing than what a Burnside Bay offers, and I think it's complementary. In terms of the services at COVE, we've had huge discussions, including some tenancy discussions with suppliers that include machine shops, 3D printing operation, business service operations, so accounting firms, law firms, bankers, HR professionals, marine engineering firms, all those companies, I'll pick on one just for a second because I don't think they'd mind Dominion Diving, which literally is right around the corner on the other end of Dartmouth Cove, the geography. We've had wonderful discussions. They want to be a part of COVE, and they don't see this as competition. They see this as pulling market right to their doorstep. So all those conversations have been very, very fruitful, even to the point of the local real estate plays in behind. So the Killam properties that are residential rental properties right behind the site, as everyone's aware, downtown Dartmouth is becoming a very happening place. And so I think COVE will bring we'll work in St. Margaret's Bay next. I think it has every opportunity to upscale the whole neighborhood. So there will be 200 plus young professionals working at COVE on a day-to-day basis. They will drive income into the rental properties, into the restaurants, into the coffee shops, probably even into the bars. So I think it's all an upgrade to the whole neighborhood from that point of view.
Thank you so much. That's certainly our hope. I guess the last question is, you mentioned the hot desks. I know I've heard conversations in the past around a membership model or sort of a hub model. Is that still anticipated, where folks could be a member but not necessarily be resident at COVE?
Yes, correct. So there's, in addition to the brick and mortar presence on a full-time basis and an itinerant come and go basis, the hot desk model applies, so you will be able to become a member of COVE. We're working through the final details of what that affinity program would include and what the costs would be, but there is certainly an appetite for that. That's particularly compelling for the companies that are already in market but might not be physically in Metro Halifax, and there's quite a number of those companies around Nova Scotia, so that's a really good model for their involvement. And it really is an extension of the programming that we're already undertaking and have undertaken over the past 5 years within IORE, things like the Ocean Connector events that go on monthly. The ocean industry has a networking event that becomes kind of the every third Thursday of the month. There's always one of these events. So that will continue as part of COVE. So yeah, there will be affinity programs. I'll go one beyond that. We also have MOU, a memorandum of understanding in place with a similar facility called the Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship in Fall River, Massachusetts, that was actually signed by the Premier about a year ago. And under the auspices of that MOU, we have a quid pro quo exchange of hot desk privileges. So an entrepreneur from Nova Scotia that wants to go explore a partnership opportunity or marketing opportunity in the New England market can essentially at no additional cost go hang out in a similar hot desk facility in Massachusetts. We plan on establishing similar relations with West Coast organization and a Western European organization over the course of the next 12 months.
Order. I let things go a little longer there because the answer was interesting there. So we